I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves.
All right, folks, we are back with another edition of Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will, two special guests, Scott Wood, Haze Lancaster, Pack of Wolves, NIL. Guys, I want to start off with apologizing for putting y'all in a situation last week. We had a podcast, and I got very heated. Will was the better half in this situation. My shots were not at y'all. It's at the system as a whole. And I got some feedback that I was too mean, and I didn't mean it. It wasn't intended that way. In particular about the transparency, somebody said that everything should be transparent. Scott and I had already talked about this after that episode went live, so this is nothing new to him. But the particular things got taken out of context there when we were talking about transparency. My issue with the whole thing, not just NIL, but is the way the system is set up currently. It's kind of patchwork. It's everybody is kind of throwing stuff at the wall, trying to make it work. And from a fan side, it's frustrating to see that. And that was where that all came from. And so that is my apology to you guys. If it came across as negative to you all in any way, I think the Pack of Wolves is probably the more important of the three departments, and that is where my concern lies with all of that. I think that was the disconnect there, and I probably didn't articulate it well because I was fuming at something else. But
yeah, it's not a perfect system, that's for sure, Will. But it's definitely going to be changing, right? It's going to be ever changing, and I think that's the thing we have to just realize, that you know what NIL looks like today, it may not be the same in 3 months, 6 months. So we're just going to have to evolve with it.
Yeah, you know, and I think people are just kind of confused, right? From a fan's perspective, they still don't know what it is, because you hear these rumors of different places operating in different ways. And I think, you know, after I talked to Scott after that episode in live, it kind of cleared it up for me. But I want to put that out there so other people can hear that message as well. Will kind of said the same thing. Like, the question I asked Scott was, why are we paying, you know, why were you going after Breon Pass, right? A guy who's already here. He's not the starter, right? You know, you hear the different ways other universities are doing things, and we are going in this direction. And I think people are like, why are we doing this, right? So if I join you, am I going to Breon Pass, or am I going to, you know, superstars trying to, you know, recruit to the program, or guys coming back? I think that's kind of where
I think it's hopefully, you know, our philosophy is that hopefully it'll be all of them, right? I mean, I think every team, every sport might be a little bit different. Our philosophy is to really try to make this thing as wide as we can, as many players as we can, as many sports as we can. Breon was a good example of, you know, we'd love to, by the time we're all said and done before the season starts, we'd love to have every single player on the men's basketball team with some type of deal, every single scholarship player. And Breon was one that he has a really good social profile. He's very active on all three platforms. And we felt like that, you know, we needed to create some traction in men's basketball. And obviously, you know, as you were saying then, and now you kind of know fast forward today, obviously, you know, Jarkel Joyner is obviously now here. He was signed. That was going on behind the scenes, right? But when the Breon question came up, it's just the way the sequence happened, right? We wanted to get Breon signed. There's some other players on that current roster that are great kids, that are good ambassadors of the university, of our program, that have been very loyal. We want to help them too. And so there'll be more names coming out, right, of more deals that we're doing as we get, you know, further into the season. But, you know, Scott and I, you know, we talked about this earlier, we've been drinking out of this NIL fire hose for about 10 or 11 weeks. It was nice to have a little break over Memorial Day to kind of reset.
Oh, well, yeah. And then you come back and we're throwing you to the fire right away. So I apologize.
Yeah, you probably spit that beer out as soon as you heard the audio.
Yeah, I think my philosophy on it, and is, again, I think it's weird to me that, and I know you guys are just dealing with the situation as best you can in the current environment. And I think the NCAA has let everybody down by letting this be a free for all and not coordinating this something to do with the athletic department. And I think somebody else had brought the question up on Twitter and said, look, athletic department makes millions a year. We're paying, you know, millions for this guy and millions for this guy. And why are we burdening the fans for that? And I think it's not y'all that put us in that position, right? It's not, and that's kind of where my angst got misdirected. It's more the NCAA has put you guys in this position where we have to do it this way currently. But, you know, I feel like they let everybody down in that regards. And are y'all feeling that kind of pressure from that?
I think, I don't know if pressure is the right word, but I think definitely, you know, a little bit of confusion and frustration, right? That this thing, you know, and talking with our compliance folks, right? Which, of course, you know, just like a lot of collectives across the country, you know, we're in regular communication with compliance at NC State. And, you know, the way they kind of explained it, right, you have this massive new deal called NIL. And notoriously, the NCAA has a massive rule book that's as thick as a phone book, right, that tells you how you can do every single thing, right, to how you walk and chew gum, right? But then they come out with NIL, which is this massive thing, and they have like only three or four rules, right? And it's created all this gray for compliance and for universities across the country of trying to interpret that, right? I mean, they live in such a black and white world, you know, up until NIL. And now you've got maybe the most explosive thing that's ever happened. And they said, we're not gonna put it out with very many rules. You know, good luck. And then when they doubled down last week, where they basically said, look, we're gonna reaffirm that collectives are booster clubs, is basically the NCAA saying, you know what rolls downhill, right? This is your problem, university. We're saying collectives are boosters, and now you've got to manage them just to make sure they understand that. And that's probably a good thing in some regards for some of this, because hopefully it will at least tamper some of the crazy stuff that's going on. That's yet to be seen.
It's where I see this going in the future, and where I think it's going to take somebody really pushing the boundaries of what's acceptable, is that some athletic department is going to say, hey, look, this doesn't make sense to do this with three separate entities at this point, right? At some point, it's like the athletic department needs to oversee this. The players are going to be employees. I don't know who's going to drive that bus, but I think that's where it's going. In order, you know, you saw Nick Saban and Jimbo Fisher shooting back at each other about playing fair and parity and all that. Like, it's not going to be, there's no parity in the current environment right there. And I think it's going to take, you know, some university to say, hey, we're putting our TV money into our players, or we're doing something like that to start this transition into a different environment.
Well, there's some states that don't have rules that prohibit a university from being directly involved in a collective. So there's some states that have no rules, and those universities are working with consultants today to say, hey, look, do we want to control this? Do we want to do our own collective? Whereas in North Carolina and a lot of states, you know, the executive orders or the orders in those states prohibit universities from being directly involved. And that does complicate things, right? That does basically force you to have this third party entity that's involved. I mean, that's not one of the NCAA rules, right? That says a university can't run their own collective. It's just been that way in most states because of state law. So there could be some of that in some of these states that don't have laws currently other than the NCAA laws in the book.
Are there any collectives that you guys are sharing practices with, or, you know, is there a group of collectives?
There is. You know, we've had some conversations with the Gator Collective. You know, they're the ones that are essentially the Kleenex of the collective, right? They started this whole concept. They were out of the gate early. They're why we call ourselves a collective today, because that's what they called themselves 8 or 9 months ago. They've been very helpful. There's kind of a consortium of collectives that are put together. There's a gal named Christy Doche, that's Business of College Sports. She has a great website that has tons of information about collectives and about the whole NIL space. She's been great to work with. She's put together a kind of a think tank of collectives that are now meeting about monthly to discuss things that are going on in the space. So, I mean, there is this industry that's kind of blowing up right in front of us, right? It's basically this, you know, some people are saying it's a $1 billion industry. I'm not sure it's that big, but it is a large industry that's kind of been blown up out of nowhere. And we're kind of watching this whole cottage industry of consultants and software firms and websites that are just blowing up out of nowhere. So from a, you know, from that perspective, it's kind of wild and exciting to kind of exist inside that.
How do you navigate that? How do you know how far to push the envelope or like, you know, or sit back and kind of see what everybody else does? Like, where does that balance come from?
Well, you know, I think that was one of the good things about maybe not being first in this deal, right? I mean, obviously we were a little bit behind the curve, not that far behind, but obviously there were some other, you know, a lot of schools were coming forward with these collectives or these NIL groups. We were a little bit late to the party, not extremely late, but it allowed us to kind of see what people were doing well, what they weren't doing well, what the structures of some of the successful collectives look like. You know, were they 501c3s? Were they for-profit LLCs? You know, how they were doing their kind of daily their daily business, and allowed us to kind of, you know, pick and choose what we think is kind of the best collection of those business practices. And then we just kind of figured out what works well for NC State, right? And I think that's important, is we can't worry about what Texas and Texas A&M are doing or Ohio State. We have to be the best version of NC State we can be. And we think we have a model and a plan that will allow us to accomplish that. And one of the things that we saw early on that was effective was that, you know, schools were typically, you know, reaching out to a well-known former student athlete, right? That you know, was kind of leading the charge. And that's ultimately how Scott really got involved. And obviously, you know, kind of our mission and Scott's mission on this kind of lined up, and that's how we kind of twisted his arm to get involved in this thing.
Yes. Yeah. Scott made it, you know, when I talked to Scott after the last episode, he made it clear about the goals and what, you know, how the Pack of Wolves is going, you know, going to operate inside the boundaries, right? How has the progress been? How has the, you know, your rollout been? It's been what, 3 weeks now? Are your numbers, like, are you guys achieving where you want to be? Is, where's that stand?
Yeah, I mean, I think we raised the amount of capital that we expected to raise by this point, right? I mean, obviously that's how we're existing, right? That's one of the reasons why we're calling ourselves a collective, right? We're raising some capital from folks that are contributing to the collective. And then we obviously have our fan site, right, which is what you're seeing mostly on the website, which is the individual sponsorships and memberships and the business sponsorships. You know, the individual memberships have been a little bit slower up to this point, right? We're seeing traction every day. We're seeing a few people sign up every day. Obviously, we got a little bump in the beginning, but there just needs to be more education, right? We need to have more conversations like this so people understand really what we're trying to do and what we're all about. Because you can go into a room full of diehard Wolfpack fans and half the room still doesn't know what the heck's going on. They don't even know what NIL is. They don't know what Pack of Wolves. You know, they don't know is it legal? Can I do these types of things? Can I support a third party entity? Are they taking away money from the Wolfpack Club? Is it going to hurt? So there is still such a education void here on what this is about. And it's so new. So we get that. You know, these types of podcasts and our athletes, student athletes getting out there and doing these things for you guys and other, you know, other sites, it just helps us with the education component. And that's what most of these student athletes are doing for us, for their, you know, for their consideration is they're helping us promote the collective and educate what the collective is all about.
Yeah. I think that education part, and that's the kind of thing that comes up quite often in our community, is folks are like, yeah, I'm going to join at some point, and they don't necessarily know, like, there's nothing that has pushed them over the edge. They don't necessarily know where their money is going, how it's helping. And, you know, what is that almost incentive to do that, right? To join as an individual. Yeah. I think that's a question that comes up all the time.
It really, the two main things are, it allows us to build programs to compensate student athletes on their NIL. And it basically keeps NC State current and competitive in the current Power Five, setup. I mean, that's really what it's about, right? It's about, you know, staying competitive in the, as the rules we know they are today, right? We talked about at the very beginning of the podcast, it's not a great formula the way it's set up, but it's the way we have to work in it today. We have to do the best version of NC State today in our collective that we can, and evolve as the rules change moving forward. And our coaches will tell you, right, they can't, you know, obviously there's a lot of uncertainty about what they can and can't say and how they can support this thing. But I can promise you that our coaches think it is very, very important. And we're hoping that we will get more support from them here soon, where they'll be able to state more directly how important NIL is to the athletics programs at NC State. I can tell you right now, there's already been at least five or six of our programs, NIL in the landscape has been very important in keeping student athletes and recruiting student athletes to the school in a, you know, in the right way, right? I mean, there's been several instances where, you know, we've been able to, within the rules, provide some information about what we're about. And it plays a part, right? It is now part of the conversation. When you're sitting in the living room with a kid or a transfer kid, especially, they want to know, do you have a platform? You know, do you have an NIL platform that's going to grow my brand, it's going to support my brand? You know, what's it about? You know, do they pay their athletes? You know, what type of structure is it? It's really important, you know, and Scott can probably add to that, but it is now part of the daily grind of recruiting and transfers. And, you know, it's another thing that coaches have to worry about. And we're trying to do the best we can to support them.
So how does that work? And without incriminating anything, but like does Kevin Keats come to the Pack of Wolves and say, hey, we need a deal for so-and-so, or these are what the deals that these guys are getting? Like, I'm not sure how to ask this question.
Yeah. Yeah. It all has to be done, you know, after the fact, right? Like we can't really have direct communication with an athlete until they've signed with your school, right? I mean, that's the way the rules are written today. That's what obviously most are breaking, right? Is that you have collectives and boosters out there that are, you know, targeting kids before they've ever had a recruiting visit or they've ever signed a letter of grant of aid with NC State or any school, right? But we're not having any communication with those players until they've signed with NC State. And then we have a general conversation of what they think the market value should be for that player. But for a lot of the players, it's not the number one thing, right? But it's part of the consideration. It's part of what they want to look at with a player. And, you know, I know here recently we had a student athlete that was, in a, we'll just say not a non-Big Three sport, right? And they were a transfer and they were looking at other schools and they needed to know what our NIL platform looked like. And the coach reached out to us and said, hey, what can we do within the rules? And we said, we can't have direct communication. You can't really talk about it. But what we can do, and this is why we signed Breon Prass and we signed some women's basketball players and we signed players in all sports, was we said what you can do is have this particular athlete talk to one of the current players that is signed in our collective, and they can tell you about the collective. And so that was absolutely instrumental and effective in helping that student athlete choose NC State. And I hope that we'll be able to provide more details about that situation down the road, because it was powerful. It was a real world example of how this works and why it's important. And it wasn't huge dollars, right? It wasn't huge dollars, but it was just having a platform, having something real, you know, having the website, having the app, I mean, having the platform that we ultimately are trying to develop these student athletes, you know, as people, you know, from a financial savvy perspective, from, you know, working on contracts and developing mentorships with business owners and former student athletes and our advisory board and our executive board, like Scott, you know, it's all part of the process, you know, and that's what we're selling. That's what we're trying to do different here at NC State that some collectives, quite frankly, aren't doing.
Yeah, it's almost like an extremely inefficient process because of the lack of rules and things like that, that you have to go find these workarounds so that you don't make a violation for answering simple questions that these athletes have. That's got to be tough.
It is. And I think, you know, I hope that that is some of the evolution of the rules changes that will occur. I mean, look, the state of Illinois just basically said what we can't do in North Carolina is now legal in the state of Illinois, where they're saying that the universities can get directly involved in negotiating deals and putting deals together. And so, you know, that's actually going above and beyond what's even in the NCAA rule book. And like what today is it legal in North Carolina because of our executive order is actually now legal in the state of Illinois. So we think there'll be some evolution with some of these state rules that the NCAA will hopefully, you know, clarify, add to some of their rule book to make it more even and consistent across the country. Because it would be nice if ahead of time, when a student athlete is considering our school, either a high school student athlete or a transfer student athlete, they want to see the collective because it's part of their consideration. And so it puts us a little bit of a disadvantage right now because of that. And so, yeah, it is frustrating, but it's the rules and we, you know, we're going to abide by them and we're going to run this thing well inside the guardrails so that when things change, you know, we can bob and weave, you know, with it.
Well, kind of along that line of contact, I know, Scott, you were quoted in this article from the Fayetteville Observer with Corey Durden, right? Was that a situation where did like Corey reach out to you guys at the Pack of Wolves and kind of explain his situation and what was going on there? Or did like David reach out in response to the article? Because I thought it was actually a pretty really moving article as to why what some of the positives of NIL can be in the future for these guys that are struggling to make certain ends meet because of other obligations. So I was curious how that whole process worked out for you.
Yeah. So they actually reached out to me, about kind of Corey's situation. Obviously, I didn't know a lot about Corey's situation. I knew, through a personal friend that has worked with the collective that he knew kind of what Corey's been going on in his life. And again, I think Corey's a more unique situation, but again, it kind of shows that with NIL now, he has help, you know, when before, you know, he's got kids, he's got some things going on, he's got a family, he's kind of out there on an island, you know, the university's limited on what they can do. And I think, you know, also to the point that, you know, sometimes a lot of people get forgotten in this and, you know, that's kind of where it comes back to Breon Pass. And what we're trying to do as a collective is we want to get to the point where we can take care of everybody. You know, we don't just because maybe they're not a, you know, high profile athlete or get, you know, getting seen, you know, catching touchdowns and all this stuff. And it may not be the sexy, you know, player, but it's about taking care of everybody because everybody's kind of going through their own thing. There are situations similar to Corey's that are throughout the university that if we can do this the right way, get this thing funded and get some backing from the university, you know, we can have an impact on a lot of these kids' lives.
Yeah, and I think Corey's situation is a perfect example where, you know, he's not currently one of our student athletes, you know, in the Pack of Wolves. Obviously, he's someone that we hope and he hopefully will be in a kind of a next group of student athletes that we'll be working with because he's got a lot of really cool things, you know, that I think make a great story for businesses and somebody you want to help. But, you know, he was, I think, approached by another business directly and has some direct NIL deals with a business directly that has been able to help him and support him. So that's great. And he needs more help, right? And I think he kind of mentioned that. And hopefully we can sync up some businesses and some individuals that are interested in helping him through the collective with certain things that we can do legally, you know, through our kind of platform. But the university, you know, and that's the thing, you know, people don't understand, you know, with the cost of attendance and the new Austin money and the cost of scholarships, I mean, they're investing a lot of money in these student athletes, and a lot more than they used to, right? I mean, this whole academic money, the Austin money that NC State, you know, really does not have to do, it's voluntary, right? But once they do it, they have to do it for every student athlete, every full scholarship player. And the university has stepped up basically in the first year they can do this. And they are going to give every student athlete at NC State a substantial amount of money through this Austin money, right? They're calling it academic money, I think, in the space, but it's almost $6,000 a year that each student athlete's now going to get by maintaining their eligibility. And that's a difference maker for most of these student athletes. And just having, you know, money to take their girlfriend out to dinner or go to, you know, put gas in their car on the weekends, or, I mean, just have spending money like most of us college students do, because they've got a full-time job. I mean, they've got a job being an athlete, and they've got a job being a student, and there's not a lot of time left to do much else. At every level of college sports today, anywhere from D3 NIA up to D1. I mean, Scott knows. I mean, it's a year-round commitment.
You guys mentioned, we kind of talked about how the recruiting no-nos, right? But how does that come into play with current student athletes and the big name that has just announced that he is pulling his name out of the draft, coming back to NC State? I think a lot of fans are excited about Jaquavion Smith. Do y'all have those conversations? Are you, like, you can have those conversations with the current player, right?
Yes, you can. Yeah, the rules are very different for, you know, I think the way they categorize them is, you know, they stay an SA is a student athlete, right? And a PSA is a prospective student athlete in the rule book. So a current player is obviously a student athlete is a SA, right? A student athlete. And yes, we can have more direct conversations with them. It's much easier, right? Like in that situation, we had conversations with Jaquavion, you know, before he or while he was, you know, in California at the combine. We kind of went through kind of where we saw his value from an NIL perspective. Kind of we you know, it's how it should work, right? Scott and I, you know, spent some time on the phone with Jaquavion and his dad. Really got to know them, explain kind of who we are, what our, you know, kind of what our platform looked like. Said, look, we're here for him. If he decides he wants to come back, we think we can put together an attractive deal for him that's a good landing spot if he needs another year to develop as a student athlete, as an athlete, as a person. And, you know, we just kind of let it all unfold. And you know, obviously we're kind of, like everybody else, watching and seeing his draft stock go up. And but at the end of the day, I think he still felt like that, you know, he loves NC State, right? And I think that was really important to him. And, you know, he's been committed to State since he was 15 years old, never really let anybody else come in the door. I think he'll have a lot of value and a lot of love for Wolfpack Nation when he comes back, and hopefully kind of leads us back to a renewed level of basketball. So yeah, we hopefully we'll see something announced with him soon. Obviously we've got to kind of get back to the details, right, to get something worked out, but yeah, we can have conversations with the current student athlete a lot easier than a prospective one.
Are we sure he didn't just come back to break Scott Wood's records?
That require him to stay all 4 years. I don't know if he's going to do that. If he breaks my records in 2 years, I mean, we're going to have to get him up in the rafters really quick.
Yeah,
he Scott's might, like that NIL money's about to run out, Turk. You know,
he might try to get up more shots than Scott next year. We'll have to see.
He could definitely get him up, but he got his work cut out if he's going to catch me by next year.
He's going to get more. He's going to get more dunks than Scott Wood next year. I can guarantee you that.
He's already got more dunks than me. I'm a rim grazer, man. I'm not a dunker.
Now, Scott, if you got 17 shots at a combine, how many are you hitting?
I only get 17.
Well, that's how many he took in that one game that everyone was getting excited. Oh, what was he, like, 7 for 17?
Are we talking game or are we talking spot shots?
Well, it was – oh, that's right.
Spot shots.
Yeah, spot shots. Spot he did shot. Do a 17. Spot shot thing, and I didn't
count. Spot shots, I think I'd put myself probably right at 15.
Okay. Jeez, what a gift.
The other high-profile athlete that has his season unjustly ended shortly, Tommy Tanks, is he on y'all's radar?
Yeah. I mean, obviously, we talked to Tommy, and you know, Tommy he is obviously someone we'd love to have involved. I mean, obviously, he's become a fan favorite of not only NC State, but he's become a national, right, brand and phenomenon. And I think because of that, you know, these higher profile athletes, there's not many of them, right, that really are national brands. You know, their agents and the people around them are just a little bit more careful about and methodical, right, about how they go about these things. And that's probably the right thing. because they just want to be very careful that they don't, you know, cross wires on certain things. So, we've had communication with Tommy and his agent and have expressed interest in having him a part of the Pack of Wolves, and they know we're here, and we hope that when the season ends, we can kind of have more conversations. But yeah, I mean, we love Tommy Tanks. We'd love to have him in the Pack of Wolves, and obviously we'd love to add some more baseball players too. So
when you guys are dealing with these negotiations, are you mainly talking with players? Are you talking with agents? Like, are you guys all of a sudden become, sports agents unwillingly?
Yeah, a little bit, but it's mostly, a lot of times you're dealing with the players. I mean, it depends on the type of deal, right? Most of our players are on non-exclusive, pretty simple deals where all they're doing is helping us promote the collective and maybe doing a few personal appearances or business appearances on our behalf or a sponsor's behalf. And so we're not really tying up a lot of their NIL value, right? They're not really extensive contracts. So most of those are pretty easy. We're not really dealing with an agent typically or a lawyer. But some of the other ones, right? I mean, yeah, they can be more extensive, and they're not many, right? But there are some that do require a little bit more. And we've got we're not lawyers and we're not agents, right? We've got consultants and lawyers that help us with that kind of stuff and help us draft our agreements to make sure that they're compliant with NCAA rules and state rules and they're legal, right? In the way they're structured. Because there's certain main, there's the kind of the no-no rules, the way the NCAA established this thing also has to be reflected in those contracts where they can't be pay to play. It can't be an inducement to come to a certain school, you know, and you have to draft the agreements in a certain way to make sure they're compliant.
Yeah. I can't imagine the learning curve where y'all are being, like you said, thrown to the fire in, you know, such a short period. It's become a second job, trying to learn the ins and outs of what you can and can't do, and then how to actually do some of these things, right?
Yeah. It's been a labor of love for sure.
Scott's rolling his eyes for some reason.
Yeah.
It's I can promise you this. What is this, 12 weeks now, Haze?
I think so. Yeah.
I can promise you, Haze Lancaster has dedicated almost every minute of this 12 weeks to NIL, man. I can promise you that. And finally, for Memorial Day weekend, we're finally able to get him to shut off his mind a little bit and actually enjoy some time. So, again, it's been a process, but Haze has dedicated a lot of time and effort towards this. I can promise you that.
Well, and right there with me has been number 15. So, S. Wood has been right there with me the whole time and is doing all of this out of the kindness of his heart and love for the university. And his passion for doing this thing the right way and having this real kind of evolution of the student athlete and really giving back to the student athlete and from his experience, helping our student athletes connect to this university better and do it better than we've done in the past for not just the Scott Woods. Cause you know, a lot of our student athletes, it works out like with Scott, but for some, we haven't done as good a job. And we need to do better with that across all of our sports. And we're doing that. And we think that through the collective and through this NIL platform, we can have a say in that, right? We can have a positive impact on that outcome.
I want to give y'all the 30 seconds, 1 minute, what's the pitch to an individual to join the Pack of Wolves? Who wants that? Scott?
Scott, hey, go for it.
Get a minute?
Yeah.
Give me a minute.
Yeah. You get as much time as you
pitch.
Want.
This is your elevator. This is your elevator pitch right here. Yep.
This is an escalator pitch if it's a minute.
Yeah, you know, I've told everybody from the start, especially since I've got involved with this, you know, I had a conversation with Evan. I'm not here to just have everybody fluff me up and say, what a great job you guys are doing with the collective. You know, there are things that we also want to improve as well. And I'm all ears for that. If you send an email to packofwolvesnil.com and go to the email, it's going to me. So any questions that anybody has, you know, about this, it is a education process. 100% it is. A lot of people don't fully understand this. We're learning as a collective as well, certain styles that we want to do and make this thing done the right way. And that's what it's about. You know, it's about taking care of these student athletes in a unique way. You know, I understand the concerns about, you know, the NCAA should have, the athletic department has the money. I don't disagree with any of that. Yeah. But I also understand for NC State to be competitive in the Power Five and to be successful, we're going to have to move forward with this in the best way we can. And if we decide that, you know what, we're just going to do it halfway, we're going to get halfway results. And I think the people that are involved with this are given a lot of time and a lot of effort that we want this to be a first-class collective. We want it to be really good. We want it to be unique so that when these student-athletes finish at NC State, one, they're leaving better off than when they first got there, and they're leaving as better human beings and have better connections than when they first got there. So, yeah. You know, we want a lot of people to join. It is, you know, again, it's an education process, and I'm here for anybody that wants to have those conversations. I'll pick up the phone, and if I got to have 40 calls a day, yeah. I'm willing to do it because, again, we're going to need everybody's help. Yeah. And we it's unfortunate how it all kind of happened, but we're here to help.
And we want to do this thing. You know, we know that we have to use our strengths, right? Our strength through our numbers. We've got a lot of Wolfpack Nation all across the country, across the world. And, you know, we need 25, 50, 100 bucks a month from thousands of those folks, right? The Gator Collective has about 3,000 members today. They're kind of the gold standard, right? We'd love to get to where they are at some point down the road, but it's going to take time. And we need all those individuals that are sitting there that want to support us, that want to make sure that we stay current, we stay competitive, to support us. 25, 50, 100 bucks at a time. They're not taking away from the dollars. You still have to go to the Wolfpack Club and the athletic department, right? Because you still got to pay for scholarships. You still got to build facilities, right? So this is another bucket, right? And I get to the frustration and the concern there that y'all had with that. I mean, it is real, right? It is a new bucket that we have to support. But it's where we are today. We're also targeting, you know, businesses that want to get involved, that want to connect directly with an athlete. We're allowing businesses or individuals that want to connect directly to a team or an athlete can come in and create a deal, right? If you want to go do a deal with one of our players that signed, approach us. We can connect you directly with that player to support that player, or you want to support that team, right? If you're big into volleyball, you want your dollars to go to volleyball, they'll go to volleyball, right? And this is why we want to get our current coaches and our former student athletes from those programs more involved to give back to their sport, to their program. That's how we drive this thing across all of our sports. It's not just football and basketball, right? It's, you know, you see it, we're signing. We've got a lot of women's basketball players signed. We signed some baseball players. We've got a soccer player that's going to be announced soon. So, you know, we've got some high profile student athletes in other sports that we're going to be signing. So we really want this thing to be for every sport at NC State. And that is unique to our platform and how we're doing it. But I think it speaks to who we are at NC State.
I think my only disappointment is I just signed up for a 1-year subscription and I didn't hear like 10 notifications go off on you and Scott's phones right now. So I was really hoping that it's right in the middle of that. Be like,
I'm going to my email right now and send you one. I can promise you that.
Yeah. Scott. Yeah. We're going to send him a special t-shirt, a special sticker packet, right? Well, I want to see that Pack a Wolf sticker on your car too. When you get that in the mail and then you tweet a picture out of that.
Yeah, we'll see. It's a company car, so I gotta be careful with that.
I'll leave y'all.
Get Windex and a razor blade; it'll always come up. Right.
I'll put it on. You know what? Here, I'll put it on my helmet here from last year.
Hey, Will, I just got a text from Molly. She said things must have gone well because he just signed up as a member.
Well, there you go. You know, you guys treat us nicer than the Wolfpack Club did, so you get my money. I'm kidding.
You're trying to get me in trouble again.
Yeah, I'm kidding. That's a joke.
We have another podcast next week to fix that.
I'm trying to mend fences here.
That's just a joke. I actually gotta probably do that too.
Will, yeah. I'll give y'all. You want to talk about innovation? Will has had this idea, and we've talked about it for months. Will, explain to them Wolfpack Social Security.
Oh man. Okay. All right. So here's my thought. You need to come up with a Wolfpack Investors Club where basically people can, you know, buy into an investment fund, and it'll be a super simple, safe one. I can get into that at any other time. But essentially, you can buy into the fund, and then you can either set your returns either to be paid out to the NIL or to athletes, or you can donate your shares to athletes so that, you know, after they come here and graduate, you know, they basically have access to something that, in theory, should continue to grow throughout time. And if, you know, given enough time, enough years, it can actually come out to a sizable number. And so we were kind of terming it, you know, Wolfpack Social Security or something like that. But, you know, we probably need some relaxation in how the rules work.
Yeah. Let's have a conversation about that for our next call, right? Talk about some, you know, have a follow up. Yeah, obviously, I'd love to. You're happy to come on here and talk Wolfpack sports and NIL with you guys anytime. Love the ideas, obviously. Love the evolution here. You know, there's all kinds of things that we're thinking about doing in the future with nonprofits and you know, Wolfpack Social Security. We'll add that to the list, right? So let's put it on the list, and we'll catch up next time. But I do have to run. My wife's calling me to dinner, so I know y'all got little kids. So I really do appreciate the time, and thank you guys so much for your platform.
Yeah, absolutely. I appreciate y'all's time, and glad to put your message out there. And you know, for us, it's an education for us. I know you guys said it's an education for y'all. I think a lot of fans are still learning as well. So again, if there's any messaging that we can help put out for you guys, we'll gladly do it. We always enjoy these conversations. It does bring a lot of clarity to, you know, where we all are and the, you know, the equal frustrations that we have with the environment that we are living in at this point.
Yeah. But well, after our next one, then hopefully Evan will join after our next one. So then we'll know we've really hit it.
Yeah. Scott, I'm gonna make Scott work for that one.
Yeah, give me a call. You got my number.
All right, thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
All right, fellas. No problem. Y'all have a good one.
Thank you.
I was raised by the wolves.